Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to have a further look at green geometry, one of the two new relativistic planar geometries that we're introducing and going to be talking more about in the future. So we have now three points, A1, A2, A3, with the usual coordinates, X1, Y1, and so on, and our aim is to do trigonometry in this green setting. So let me remind you that the quadrants between points in the green setting is defined by an expression like this. So Q1, the quadrants between A2 and A3, is 2 times the difference in the x coordinates times the difference in the y coordinates. And similarly, we have Q2, the green quadrants between A1 and A3, and Q3, the quadrants between A1 and A2. So those are the three quadrants of this triangle. And what about the spreads? Well, spread S1 is the spread between A1, A2, and A1, A3. In other words, the spread at the vertex A1. And how do we compute that? Well, in terms of the vectors, here's the vector A1, A2 joining A1 to A2. Here's the vector A1, A3 joining A1 to A3. And here's the expression for the spread. What's it look like? Well, it has a term in the numerator that's the same as the expression for the spread in the blue and in the red geometries. It's this quantity times this minus this times this. All of that squared. There's also a minus sign out front, which is very important to remember. And in the denominator, we have a 4 times a product of 4 things that are appearing in those vectors. So that's the expression for the spread at the vertex A1. And similarly, there's expressions for the spread at S2 and spread at S3. So what are the trigonometric laws that are going to hold for these three quadrants and the three spreads? Well, you're probably not too surprised to find out that they're exactly the same as the trigonometric laws that hold in familiar Euclidean geometry, which are the same as the trigonometric laws that hold in the red geometry. And the way we establish that is by establishing the most powerful law first, the cross law. So let's have a look at how we establish this cross law. Here is the cross law that we're trying to establish. And let's start with the right-hand side first, which has a factor 1 minus S1. That's very convenient because in our last video, we defined S1 in terms of 1 minus another expression. So we really already have an expression for 1 minus S1. It is this quantity here. So this is the inner product that's occurring between those two vectors that we wrote down on the previous page. The green inner product, it's squared, and then there's a denominator as well. But when we multiply by Q2 and Q3, the Q2 and the Q3 exactly cancel the denominators that are appearing in the last slide. And so this right-hand side of the cross law is this expression right here. And the left-hand side, well, let's look at Q1 minus Q2 minus Q3. There's Q1. We're subtracting Q2 and also subtracting Q3. And again, you have to expand all of these things out, and there's some cancellation, and then you collect terms. And then you can see that you can rearrange that as minus 2 times this expression here, where this expression is exactly the same as appearing up there, telling us that if we square this, we're going to get a 4 times this thing squared, so we're going to get the right-hand side. And that establishes the cross law for us. And as we've seen, both in the blue geometry, I think it was video 43, and in the red geometry, once you've established the cross law, the other trigonometric laws follow from it. So Pythagoras' theorem, in the case when you have two sides which are perpendicular in the green sense, the triple quad formula in case you have three points which are collinear, and then these two formulas, the spread law and the triple spread formula, which are valid for any triangle. These hold almost automatically once we've established the cross law. And so the familiar five laws of trigonometry are here for us just as they are in the blue and in the red geometries. Now let's have a look at what circles look like in this setting. The circles in this geometry are also rectangular hyperbolas, but they're oriented a different way than in red relativistic geometry. They're oriented so that the asymptotes are the coordinate axes which play the role of the null circles. So it's simple if we think of the origin as being our center of our circle, in which case the unit circle has equation 2xy equals 1, and that's right here, that branch together with that branch. The null circle has equation 2xy equals 0, which tells us that either x equals 0 or y equals 0, so we are getting the coordinate axes. And then there's this minus unit circle, 2xy equals minus 1, given by the dotted lines here. Now this is just a rotation of the picture for red geometry, and the connection between the two of them is very familiar to physicists who work in relativistic geometry, because they know that you can change coordinates by taking the null lines as basis vectors in the usual relativistic geometry to convert the red geometry to a green picture like this. And so there's actually sort of two different ways. Red and green are just two different ways of looking at the same geometry from a relativistic point of view. The advantage in the green geometry is that some of the computations are a lot simpler. For example, we can see that we can parameterize this unit circle in a relatively simple way in green geometry. If we want to parameterize this curve, we can set x to be a parameter t. And once x is t, then we can solve for y. It's going to be 1 over 2t. So this gives a parameterization of this curve. In other words, as t varies, this pair of points traverses the curve. And that gives us another approach to proving theorems about these circles. So here's a good example that I'll leave as an exercise for you. It's a little bit involved, but it's a very rewarding exercise and has a number of interesting features once you get into it. It's exactly the equal products theorem that we talked about in the 10th video in our series on ordinary circles. And it says that if you have 4 points on the circle, in fact on any circle, and you look at where these two lines meet, then we have 4 quadrances. Let's call that one Q1, that one Q2, that one Q3, and that one Q4. Of course, all these quadrances are now in the green setting. The statement is then that the product of Q1 times Q2 equals the product between Q3 and Q4. And I suggest that you try proving it in both ways, first following the WildTrig 10 video, and also by doing it directly by using this parameterization, calculating the equations of this line, calculating this point of intersection in terms of the arbitrary constants T1, T2, T3, T4, and then computing these quadrances and computing both sides of these equations. So we now have our three geometries that are going to fit together in a very nice way. And to clarify the relationship between these three, we're going to go back to this Pythagorean triple identity that we talked about in the last video. So we're going to talk about Pythagorean triples and go back to the ancient Greeks and establish a little bit of number theory concerning Pythagorean triangles. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.